created immediately after Roosevelt took office. First dams are all 1933 when Roosevelt first came in. They began construction. Wheeler Dam, Chickamauga, construction. We didn't have any money. We had nothing to do this with, and we did it. Operational, 1936. Beautiful turbine going in to make electricity with. Fontana Dam, during the war, they stepped it up. Operational. Production of ammonium nitrate for fertilizer at TVA. So TVA projects were being studied from people from all over the world, sent engineers and politicians, and we sent experts and engineers to them. And this is Russia, China, Mexico, South America, India. And it started at the very beginning. This is the 19th, you see the dates are of these articles are at the bottom. In 1934, Brazil changed its constitution to reflect what TVA was doing, and because they were going to do similar things. Morris L. Cook was the director of the Rural Electrification Administration. He was an expert in applying electricity to lift the population from misery and create a modern workforce. In 1936, Franklin Roosevelt went to Argentina for a Pan American conference. And there were mass crowds that were thrilled to see that power was being exerted by a benefactor of humanity. This was noted throughout the world. This shook the world at that time, because the United States had reversed the earlier 20th century policy with the good neighbor policy. Roosevelt met in Buenos Aires Getúlio Vargas, the president of Brazil. And Roosevelt refers to him as the second man who created the New Deal. In 1941, Roosevelt and Churchill met on a battleship, and they issued jointly what was called the Atlantic Charter. It had been drafted by Sumner Wells. And this is Sumner Wells' typed copy of the original of a draft with Franklin Roosevelt's corrections. Wells was FDR's policy chief at the State Department, not Cordell Hull, the Secretary of State. Certain common principles on which they based their hopes for a better future for the world. This was what we were fighting for, and this became the standard for all representatives of Franklin Roosevelt, and it was rejected by all of his opponents, domestic and abroad, that is, the real opponents. But this was the rallying point, the Atlantic Charter. They respect the right of all peoples to choose the form of government under which they will live, and they wish to see sovereign rights and self-government restored to those who have been forcibly deprived of them, and to bring about improved labor standards, economic advancement, and social security. British Empire leader Winston Churchill doesn't apply to our empire. He said this in a speech in London in 42. Let me make this clear in case there should be any mistake about it. I have not become the King's first minister to preside over the liquidation of the British Empire, that society of nations and communities gathered in and around the ancient British monarchy. Sumner Wells, brought in Lawrence Duggan to run the Latin American desk of the State Department. And Welles and the Duggan family are old family friends of Franklin Roosevelt. This is, on the right is Lawrence Duggan, a very young man. The United States was issuing loans before we got in World War II to South American countries to establish industries, large loans. Steel and electric railways for Brazil, hydroelectric projects. In 1942, Franklin Roosevelt brought Morris Cook, the man from the Rural Electrification Administration, and said, go to Brazil, and we're going to transform Brazil. We could not do that in the world as a whole because World War II is raging. But we could do it. We could begin to do it in South America. This is not simply a plan. This was done. And these are Roosevelt's words for what we're going to do. We're going to industrialize Brazil. And he's doing this with the Brazilians, cheering and full of hope and pride. Cook wrote this book, Brazil on the March. Roosevelt went there in 1943. That's right next to Africa. Brazil is, I go about 1,000 miles closer to the Eastern Hemisphere. So it was a war corridor. So he met again with the Brazilian president, who's in, and then on Vargas's right over there is Harry Hopkins. They began the great steel complex in Brazil with railways going to the appropriate cities and supply points. This now still produces 5 million tons of steel a year. This is Brazil's steel complex, and we started it. It was financed partly by Brazil and partly by our Exim Bank. This is from the book by Morris Cook, Pump House and Blast Furnace. And there it is, later shot, very bad photograph. Roosevelt sent Henry Wallace to Asia in 1943. And this is the pamphlet that Henry Wallace wrote and published in 1944 for rapid industrialization of Asia on a vast scale. There is a map in the book. There are two Asias, just like we had the house divided in the United States for Lincoln. Free Asia and subject Asia. The free countries are Russia, China, Thailand, the Philippines, and Australia. And the subject countries are India, Burma, and the Netherlands, Indies.
These are Wallace's words?
This is from the book. This is his words. If it looks like it's a quote from the source, you'll see that easily. If it's my words, you'll see it also.
Why subject? Because under British control or Japanese control?
No, under British.
British control.
Yeah, under British.
And French.
And French and Dutch. But as you'll see, here's Alaska needs to be a much larger population. I can't see it so well here from here. Sorry. Needs a much larger population than at present to service the rail, motor, and air routes which will link America and Asia. We have to master the problems of the far north. And that's his map. This is all from the book published in 44. And as the appendix, the Atlantic Charter, which is Franklin Roosevelt's pledge to displace imperialism. In 1938, the president of Mexico, Lázaro Cárdenas, took over Shell Oil and Standard Oil. Those properties were not worth $400 million, like the headline says, but he took them over. And here is the American ambassador, the guy in the middle, Josephus Daniels. The Mexican president is on the left. Here's a photograph, and go back to World War I so you see what's happening here. On the left is Thomas Edison. Right next to him is Josephus Daniels. Over on the right is Franklin Roosevelt. Josephus Daniels was Secretary of the Navy in World War I. He appointed Thomas Edison to head up an invention board for the Navy. Daniels was Secretary of Navy. His assistant secretary is Franklin Roosevelt. They were in an anti-British faction in the Navy, leading that faction of the Wilson administration with Admiral Benson and Fleet Admiral Henry Wilson. As president, Franklin Roosevelt sent his old boss, Josephus Daniels, to Mexico to stand up to the British and Wall Street. Okay. So here is the president of Mexico reading the nationalization order and the American ambassador standing by his side. This was a very big deal in Mexico. This was the heart of their sense of existence. There was a huge demonstration on the anniversary a year later. And Franklin Roosevelt backed this, the takeover of the foreign oil holdings, and he rejected the inflated claims of Britain's Shell Oil and Wall Street's Standard Oil. You're going to see many newspaper items in this program where the words in the newspaper are not something that newspaper would have cared to say, but they've been put there by the President of the United States. This one and a later one. In the book written about this whole thing by Ambassador Daniels, he says, it was fortunate for all concerned the U.S. was represented in negotiating with the Mexicans by Morris L. Cook. That's the guy from the rural electrification. An able, distinguished, and just economist and expert. So he was in the negotiations with Mexico on FDR's side. And Daniels also explained about this man in the inset, Patrick Hurley, who was involved to settle this. Hurley had an Irish Republican father. He had to leave Ireland. They moved to Indian Territory, where Hurley grew up with the Choctaws and became their national lawyer. He was Secretary of War for Herbert Hoover. He was a Republican. And he got into Sinclair Oil Company. And in the negotiations with Mexico, he went down there and made a deal for Sinclair Oil with the Mexican government. And that was the end of Standard Oil and Shell. That's what happened next, or happened early in the negotiations. They stuck with Franklin Roosevelt. They broke Mexico's relations with England. This is a cartoon, a very affectionate cartoon, in Mexico when Josephus Daniels, the ambassador, left. They loved him. Iran, 1943, December. You see Stalin, Roosevelt, and Churchill. I think they posed for this photograph about 3 hours, sitting there on the porch with Roosevelt slouching. I mean, with Churchill on the right there. This is a meeting to formulate the plans to win the war. Invasion of Normandy and Russia comes into the war to finish the war in Asia. There's the photographers. Franklin Roosevelt's personal representative, Patrick Hurley, the same one from the Mexico negotiations, made the strategic arrangements. He got the Russians to put FDR and his staff to live in the Russian embassy during this conference. And it was Patrick Hurley who framed the Iran declaration by the big three powers, a mutual pledge of sovereignty for the nation of Iran. And this would be the basis for post-war international cooperation. Then, in Tehran, following the conference, Roosevelt asked Hurley to draft the American plan for transforming Iran itself as our model for developing the world's poor nations. This is the memorandum was drafted by Patrick Hurley. I found it in the National Archives. It's never been published. And this is mentioned in Elliot Roosevelt's book, or the fact that he was going to be asked to write something like this, that Hurley would. He says the imperialisms, well, I have to step over here because the light is in the way. If imperialism is dead, it seems very reluctant to lie down. And he mentions, what are the imperialisms? Germany, Japan, Italy, France, Belgium, Portugal, and the Netherlands. Well, those are the imperialisms, right? All sort of alike. Oh my God, the Nazis and the Dutch and the French, that's all alike. Yeah, but then there's the real bad one. The British imperialism seems to have acquired a new life from the blood and productivity and liberty that a free nation is giving it, defended by the blood of soldiers of the most democratic nation. We're approaching the irrepressible conflict between worldwide imperialism and worldwide democracy. Keep in mind, this is the memorandum, more or less dictated by Franklin Roosevelt and then used by him in the administration as our policy for post-war world. He discusses in here the development of transportation, communications, industry, sanitation, education for Iran. What's going to get in the way of this? Imperialism. We are running up against an irrepressible conflict between democracy and imperialism. I think that was on the last slide. Russia has earned itself an assured place as a first-class world power. This man is really a dedicated anti-communist and a Republican. And also, Iranian officials want America to come in with business to help develop Iran, as well as American experts. I think we better have our government vet and check any businessman from America that goes over there before they get in there. Franklin Roosevelt wrote this cover letter and circulated the Hurley Memorandum within the United States government. Is it possible to...
Should I read that?
Yes. I'd like you to read the first three paragraphs, would you?
Enclosed is a very interesting letter from Pat Hurley. It is in general along the lines of my talk with him. Iran is definitely a very, very backward nation. It consists really of a series of tribes, and 99% of the population is, in effect, in bondage to the other 1%. The 99% do not own their land and cannot keep their own production or convert it into money or property. I was rather thrilled with the idea of using Iran as an example of what we could do by an unselfish American policy. We could not take on a more difficult nation than Iran. I would like, however, to have a try at it. The real difficulty is to get the right kind of American experts who would be loyal to their ideals, not fight among themselves, and be absolutely honest financially.
This was then sent to Winston Churchill by President Roosevelt. And I don't have time to read it, but he's having a lot of fun sending this to Winston. Sent this in February 44 with my warm regards. And 3 months later, Winston Churchill replied to that letter. He said, "British imperialism has spread and is spreading democracy more widely than any other system of government since the beginning of time." At that time, the British were in active mode for what amounted to the assassination of Franklin Roosevelt. They never killed him, but they did everything possible to kill his government, and this the coup against him started in 1943.
That's funny. It says, "The general seems to have some ideas about British imperialism, which I confess make me rub my eyes. He makes out, for example, that there's an irrepressible conflict between imperialism and democracy."
Right. After Roosevelt was dead, the Sultan of Morocco, who was also head of the Arab League, said publicly that Franklin Roosevelt had promised to intervene and help bring Morocco to freedom from French imperialism. And he said that Winston Churchill had not joined President Roosevelt in the promise. If Churchill had his way, imperialism would continue forever. This didn't belong to England. So keep that in mind, that when you're thinking about nations and their connection to imperialism, it's a very loose idea. You'll see this especially in Africa. So Roosevelt sponsored Arab nationalism against the British and French empires. And the British apparatus intervened to substitute Harry Truman for Henry Wallace for vice president on the 1944 ticket. But after Franklin Roosevelt's death, Harry Hopkins and others in the administration, in the continuing Truman administration, tried to keep the Franklin Roosevelt policy going under Truman against British pressure and against treason from insiders here. By 1946, the coup was ready for public unveiling by Churchill in person. It's useful to glance at the character of the British Empire team in this coup in London and Washington. This is from the website of the Churchill Center at the Churchill War Rooms in London, and it's written by Churchill's official biographer and posted on Churchill's own website. And it describes Churchill's leadership of the eugenics movement in England, where he's calling for the sterilization of the unfit. He goes on at length about who is unfit. And we're faced with the problem that the birth of unfit people is unchecked by any of the old restraints of nature and fostered by civilized conditions. That's our real problem. So he called for compulsory sterilization, a simple surgical operation so the inferior could be permitted freely in the world without causing much inconvenience to others. He spoke about setting up, as Home Minister of England, he spoke about setting up forced labor camps for mental defectives. This part here is not in the on the Churchill website, but it's in all the newspapers. He was vice president of the first International Congress of Eugenics in 1812. I'm sorry, 1912. He was thinking like 1812. This is an article written in 1920 by Winston Churchill, Right Honorable Sir Winston Churchill, and it's about the worldwide satanic, diabolical Jewish conspiracy to enslave the world under communism. He talks about, it starts off, some people like Jews and some do not. This same astounding race may be producing in other systems of morals and philosophy, malevolent, it may shatter irretrievably Christianity, it's the gospel of the Antichrist, and so forth. The schemes of the international Jews, a sinister confederacy, a worldwide conspiracy. He takes it back to the French Revolution. You probably hear that from your populist contacts half the time. And then it's mainly the communist revolution of today. And the Jews have been allowed to prey upon the temporary prostration of the German people. This is in 1920. So 3 years later, Hitler would use this theme in his coup attempt in 1923. He ends with a deal for the Jews. I'm not going to press this on you if you'll back Britain's plan for Zionism. And we need to secure this homeland for the Jewish race, which will be under the protection of the British crown. Over in America, the Harriman family founded the eugenics headquarters for the United States in 1911 to promote the doctrine of the British Home Secretary. Winston Churchill wrote the Mental Defectives Act, which was enacted shortly after he left office. But this was then promoted by the office set up by the Harriman family. And this is, I think, a very remarkable document here. This is the report published by the eugenics organization in 1932 when they had a meeting, worldwide meeting with all Nazis there and so forth. And the whole thing is dedicated to the mother of Averill Harriman, Mrs. E.H. Harriman, founder of the Eugenics Records Office. You go down in the document and it says, Mrs. E.H. Harriman, address 39 Broadway, deceased. Okay, the dead woman who's paying for this, her address is 39 Broadway. Well, what's 39 Broadway? How come this lady lives at 39 Broadway? What is that? There's 39 Broadway. It's the home of the bank set up to finance the Nazi Party of Germany for this man, Fritz Thyssen. Was established in 1922 before Hitler's first coup attempt, and to help pay for that. And this is about Dr. Thyssen, a friend and supporter of Herr Hitler, and so forth. The bankers are sending, now that you have a couple of other fellows, the Dulles brothers. They're sending John Foster Dulles to Berlin to meet with the Hitler regime when it first came in. And there is Brown Brothers Harriman and Company. The Harriman Bank merged with the English bank Brown Brothers, run under the direction of the head of the Bank of England. And they are sending John Foster Dulles to meet with Hitler. He was their envoy to Adolf Hitler, and they were his lawyers, both John Foster and Allen. There is Lord Halifax on our left, and to the right is Hermann Göring. And Halifax was the Viceroy of India. he's known as Lord Irwin then, before Halifax. He arrested Mahatma Gandhi in India. In this period, in the 1930s, he was the head of the pro-Hitler faction in politics in Britain, and very, very close to the royal family. His wife was lady-in-waiting to the royals. Now we're going to see something here. There it is.
Lord Halifax spends the last few days of his tour as the guest of General Goering on the latter's Prussian estates. And though the guest sticks to his bowler, the host wears the sort of hat that would create a diversion in Piccadilly. Britain's envoy has proved himself such an expert on the subject of hunting that the Germans have dubbed him Sir Tally-Ho-Fax. And of course General Goering is his country's master of the hunt, so the two have something in common. But somehow we suspect that what they're hunting for is a political formula. Why don't they ask the bison? Maybe they could tell them something about living in peace.
So this is 1937. He wasn't even in the government at that point, but he was sent as British representative to meet with the Nazis and tell them, you have a green light for Hitler's conquests. So then Halifax was Neville Chamberlain's foreign minister, and he is the one who personally made the deals to give Europe to Adolf Hitler. This is in Munich. Here is the second from the left is Sumner Wells. I think this is 1940. On the left is the British foreign minister, Lord Halifax. Over here is the Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain. And to the right is our ambassador, Joe Kennedy, father of John Kennedy. Halifax was Joe Kennedy's main contact with the Nazis. That is, that's how he plugged into the Nazis, is through this gang of the upper oligarchy in England. Churchill, as Prime Minister, made Lord Halifax the arch-Nazi ambassador to the United States for the entire World War II. And he was here to help Churchill bring about the coup against Roosevelt at the end of the war. In 1944, Franklin Roosevelt differed publicly with Churchill on the question of continuing fascism in Spain. Roosevelt didn't like it, and Churchill did, and said so publicly. Eleanor Roosevelt, when asked about it, basically said that Churchill has been a fascist for 60 years. And that's the long and the short of it. Okay, so following FDR's death, I'm picking out two people as crucial in this that are very publicly identifiable. Obviously, there are other people not so much in that way, but these are up front, Acheson and Harriman. The first crisis of the Cold War, so-called, was over Iran in late 1945. And there were Senate hearings, and there's General Hurley from the 1880s Indian Territory and the Iran guy blasting Acheson, Dean Acheson, who's in the State Department, for destroying President Roosevelt's policy for Iran. Dean Acheson's father was a Northern Ireland Belfast man. His mother was British. And in his family in Massachusetts, they celebrated all the royal family's holidays. And he was more pro-British Empire than any Englishman. I think that's kind of standard for probably people in that kind of condition. Uh-oh. Let's go back. Sorry. So Hurley deeply embarrassed him by revealing that he had sabotaged And the Hurley memorandum had circulated with Roosevelt's cover letter, and it was denounced back during the war by Acheson. And he, on his denunciation, he said that this was hysterical, messianic globaloney. He was a minor State Department person at the time. There it is. Nevertheless, here is our Secretary of State under the first one under Truman, Jimmy Burns on the right, and the Russian and British foreign ministers at a meeting in Moscow. And this is, I think, the turning point, you could say, of this whole situation. Burns is trying to continue with some aspects of Franklin Roosevelt's policy in the world. And our ambassador to Russia, Averill Harriman, met with the British representatives privately and told them, our Secretary of State does not represent our policy now. Disregard him, he's a fool. And he spread rumors and gossip against him. And there's a quote from how he was undermined by Harriman, who then was working on Truman, as were other people. Oh, I wanted to mention that, of course, Harriman went to the Churchill household in 1940 and had a sexual affair with the Churchill's son's wife while the son, Randolph, was off fighting in the army. He later married this woman. Her name was Pamela Churchill. That's Pamela Harriman. So he has a very strange relationship, a bond with Churchill. So here is the article about Churchill coming to, after he met with Truman in the White House, he went down to Florida and met with Jimmy Burns down there and laid down the law. And Burns was morally crippled at that point and completely surrendered. And it says here that they will announce the terms of the surrender, basically, in the speech coming up in Fulton, Missouri, by Churchill, who says we're merging the American government and the British Empire to fight communism. Harriman was going to be Secretary of Commerce, Strategy Coordinator for NATO, and the U.S. is swallowed into the British Empire.
What, do you want a small thing?
Yeah.
The Iron Curtain phrase actually came a year earlier from Goebbels.
From Goebbels, yes, that's right. It was a Nazi phrase. But then, how did the Nazis get it? Do a little deeper, you're going to probably get back to Churchill or what have you. But that's right, exactly right. This is all completely discredited at the time, but people were scared. Why were they scared? Well, Lawrence Duggan, who was the director of the Good Neighbor Policy, was murdered in 1948, thrown out a window, an obvious murder. They didn't try to cover it up. It was just totally obvious. And then within hours, they called him a communist. And if you go into the so-called internet, you know, Wikipedia, that's the line about him. The most incredibly stupid slander. This guy is a super patriot. And also a direct representative of Franklin Roosevelt. This is from the book by Dean Acheson. When he became Secretary of State for Truman, I made the offer, unorthodox proposal, to the British ambassador, Sir Oliver Franks. We're going to talk regularly in secret, and we'll go to his residence or mine, and no one was going to be informed about this. He was made virtually, essentially a member of the cabinet, the British ambassador. At that time, Kim Philby was the first secretary of the British embassy. Very confusing, right? It's good. It's good to be confused about these things. Here is Dean Acheson in London. There's the British Prime Minister Attlee laughing. Here is the Republican, John Foster Dulles, appointed by the Democratic President Truman as advisor to Secretary of State Dean Acheson. Dulles went immediately to Korea, to the Korean border. It was quiet on the Korean border, tense but quiet. And while he was there, there's Dulles and Acheson, Republican and Democrat, the party system. While he was there, the Korean War started. There is the British ambassador, Franks, Truman, and Acheson. In 1951, Dr. Mohammad Mossadegh in Iran came up to take over the oil, British oil monopoly, known later as British Petroleum Company, BP. And he came into office to do that. He became prime minister. Keep in mind, in this Iran overthrow of Mossadegh, this is 51. Go back, as the people at that time did, to 1938, 13 years earlier, when the Mexicans, with America's backing, took over these fraudulent claims of the international oil companies, and they broke with the British. New York Times lies that this is a problem of communism, and no person ever said or believed that he was a communist. Nobody said that, but they imply it. Truman appointed Alan Dulles head of covert operations in the Central Intelligence Agency. Dulles and his second, Frank Wisner, were both proteges, not proteges, but close to and completely associated with Acheson. And Dulles's, he had learned from his uncle's friend. His uncle was Lansing in World War I, the Secretary of State who betrayed us to the British. And they had a friend named Captain Gaunt from British Intelligence, and he was the model for Alan Dulles, who thought he was the most exciting person, Captain Gaunt. This is the Truman policy memo just before they left office, officially setting up the interagency and also U.S.-British official cooperation for overthrowing the government of Iran. And then here is the memo right after Eisenhower comes in, Alan Dulles as CIA director and John Foster as Secretary of State. They said, okay, we've been planning this, now we're ready to go with a coup. Mossadegh was overthrown by the CIA and British intelligence, a disgrace for the United States. John Kennedy, here he is in World War II. His commander-in-chief is Franklin Roosevelt. This is a defining number of years for his soul, and particularly because he is defying his father. And he knows what his father's up to, not just that he's pro-Hitler. He knows the whole thing about the British. 1954, he's in Congress. He's a senator by this time. He actually had toured Asia and India. So here he's calling for liberty as the key to victory. If the West wants to have a victory in Indochina, they should give them liberty. In other words, end the colonial status. Here's his famous speech backing independence for Algeria in 1957. And the title given by him to that speech, Imperialism, the Enemy of Freedom. This shook the world and shook the Arab world and the so-called neutralists and the Africans. It's sort of parallel to the Atlantic Charter almost, but he's not even in power, he's just a senator.
Can you read this?
You read just the first, we'll just read the next one here. This is he makes speeches like this all the time. This is what he's doing. So call it nationalism, call it anti-colonialism. Africa's going through a revolution. They want a higher standard of living. They live by subsistence agriculture. They want an opportunity to manage and benefit directly from the resources in, on, and under their land. They want to govern their own affairs. It was in our schools that some of the most renowned African leaders learned about dignity and equality. And he's referring here in particular to his developing friendship for Kwame Nkrumah, the father of African nationalism, who came here to the United States and was here 10 years before he went back to Ghana. We'll get to that in a second. This is more in the campaign. Kennedy, before he was president, after he was elected, sent Senator Frank Moss, the leader of the NWAPA program, to Africa to spread the idea that America is coming in with TVA and like actions. That's the new plan. There was a terrible bloodbath going on in the Congo at the time. And just before Kennedy came in, the president or the prime minister, Lumumba, was slaughtered by Alan Dulles, the Belgians, and British intelligence 3 days before Kennedy could take office, because he wouldn't have approved of it. Kennedy is conferring with Nkrumah on the Congo, because Nkrumah is the leader of the opposition to the imperialists, and Kennedy that's part of Kennedy's team. He was the first foreign head of state to visit the White House. Do you see the cursor? Or I'm supposed to press this red button? Yeah, this is being greeted with a red carpet at the airport. And they're both speaking, Kennedy and Nkrumah. All right, I'm going to go on. The next month, President Sukarno of Indonesia came, another man denounced as a red enemy, and visited with Kennedy. There he is with Kennedy and Caroline at the White House. And here in 1962, this is the big humiliation for the British. President Kennedy fought the British directly in the Congo because it was the British who were the most important, if not the majority, owners of the mineral resources of Katanga province, right next to Rhodesia. And this includes British lords on the board. It includes the Rothschild family, bankers who are international in Europe and England. And the British sponsored a breakaway of that mineral-rich province of the Congo. Kennedy said, we are not going to allow that. We are not going to allow sovereign nations to be broken up. And with the support, at least the nominal support of the Belgian government, this is the former Belgian Congo, Paul-Henri Spaak was prime minister, supporting Kennedy so that the British were the only support in public for this murderous secession of Katanga province. Kennedy got the United Nations armed and they went in and crushed the secession while Kennedy was alive. And that was a terrible humiliation and defeat for the British Empire. And they were writing things at the time about, we're losing everything. Why were they losing everything? It wasn't just this, but you get an idea of this as we see from here now. This is 3 months before his murder, right after Martin Luther King's speech. There's Dr. King on the left and Walter Reuther over here. So he had the backing of civil rights and labor in the United States. He's working together with the coming up leaders of all of Asia and Africa and South America. And his friends are dominating Europe, except for England. And I don't doubt that he had a lot of friends in England, too, who didn't care to just exterminate civilization. Here is the October 11th memorandum. The president plans to withdraw 1,000 military personnel by the end of 63 from Vietnam. There's more on this. This is 9 days, or what, 7 days before his assassination. What's the real geometry here? To get the idea of this revival of Franklin Roosevelt, let's go over to Europe briefly, Enrico Mattei, and Kwame Nkrumah in Africa. 1945, Enrico Mattei, General Mattei, is decorated by the U.S. Army for patriotism for opposing Mussolini, head of the partisans. And in dealing with Iran, he took over Mussolini's old oil company, and they said, take it down. He said, well, why don't we make something good out of it? And so he became the real power in Italy and set up a state oil company that was into other countries as well for the benefit of mankind. He dealt with Iran directly with the Shah, provided a wife for the Shah, undercut the British in all kinds of ways. He's a very clever man. And undercut the consortium that had taken over Iran. The Iran oil companies that, on the so-called American coup, was majority British in 1954, after the coup. And so he would give them, the Iranians, 50% profits. The cartel was going to give them 25%. And they began shipping oil into Italy and working with him. He was pushing hard for nuclear power development. This is 1958. Here he is at the launching of Italy's nuclear power plant, his project. And here he's getting Iranian oil in the mid-50s, after the coup by the British and so-called Americans. Now down into the British West African colony called Gold Coast, which would be renamed by Kwame Nkrumah Ghana, an ancient name. We want a Tennessee Valley Authority type of project on the Volta River. That is the key to our development. What is our development? Not just our little country, but to give electricity to West Africa. And they wanted to make Ghana the industrial center that would give the lead to Africa with a new harbor and interior communications. This is really important. He was in the United States from the mid-30s into the 40s. When he left America in 1945, seeing the Statue of Liberty through a mist of tears and thinking, you have opened my eyes to the true meaning of liberty. I shall never rest until I have carried your message to Africa. This is a son of Africa and of the Franklin Roosevelt and Lincoln tradition in the United States. He went to Lincoln University in Pennsylvania and was completely bound up with American civil rights leaders from the 30s into the 60s, when he came to visit Dr. King, Adam Clayton Powell, and others visited with him.
Well, 1957 about his visit to Ghana.
Oh, he went to Ghana, yeah.
To Ghana for the independence.
For the independence of Ghana, right.
Beautiful speech he gives.
Yeah, we have to get. I have to get that. So the project for building this great dam was supervised by Edgar Kaiser, his father Henry Kaiser. Some of you may remember a car named the Henry Kaiser or something like that. But he was the shipbuilder in World War II for Franklin Roosevelt. This is his son that owns the Kaiser Aluminum Company. So their deal is that they're going to organize other companies to make this great electric project with a dam and use it to melt the ore of aluminum, to produce aluminum. This is from the website of the Italian State Oil Company. 5 days before Kennedy took office, Enrico Mattei visited with Kwame Nkrumah. What's that about? And the Ghanaians, Ghana people, I don't know if that's Ghanaians, but they talk about back in the 50s, Mattei sending his people to Italy to meet with and work strategy out with his close friend, Signor Enrico Mattei. So here's the meeting. Kennedy's going to come in office in 5 days. What are they meeting about? Italian engineers built the dam. Americans supervised it. And Kennedy financed it. A constant stream of abuse against this in the papers in London and United States. Actually, London, in the beginning, they said they wanted to build the dam. And no doubt under different conditions, they might have built something there. In fact, they did build something there. But you know what types of things they do in their colonies. It's not with the same intention. And Nkrumah says, I want to pay particular tribute to President Kennedy and the U.S. government. The personal interest shown by the president in this vast project means a great deal to me personally and to the people of Ghana. The U.S. government organized the loans and the money to build this dam. And here is, you see the outline of the nation of Ghana. There's the lake. That is the largest artificial lake in the world to the present day. And here is the dam, and you see a portion of the lake going into the distance. When Kennedy was murdered, Nkrumah said that Kennedy had carried on what Abraham Lincoln began 100 years ago, and he didn't just mean ending slavery. This is what Lincoln did, only with railroads and so forth, and steel mills, right? But Africans will remember him above all for his uncompromising stand against racial and religious bigotry, intolerance, and injustice. This is an article back in the 50s by Elspeth Huxley. Her husband, who gave her her last name, is a first cousin of Aldous and Julian Huxley, and one of the worst people in that family. That's saying something, yes. And her family, her own family and her husband's are in the British Empire, both in London propaganda and in Africa. She's raised in Africa as a white overlord. This is about Ghana's dangerous plans. And she writes a series in the New York Times, this British lady. The Great Volta River Project, which will put this cocoa colony on the world map, is to go through. And it will mean cheap power for backward Africa. Assembly lines for ex-cannibals. The scheme may take 20 years to complete. And then she's talking about how it can be disrupted with tribalism and other games. And Nkrumah reports plot to slay him. 1958, New York Times. Foreign financed plot is charged by Ghana, 1959. Oh, some unspecified foreign country. Oh, the opposition leader flees to London. Queen visits Ghana. Bombs explode. Five days before Queen Elizabeth was to visit here. Third and fourth bombs explode a little bit earlier to her, closer to her visit. Duncan Sandys, son-in-law of Winston Churchill's Commonwealth spokesman. Oh, sorry about that. He was then running Lonro for Tiny Roland later on. Al Gore, senior, father of our Al Gore, went to Ghana. He took over the Senate Foreign Relations Committee's Africa subcommittee. And he was the leader of the opposition to this Kennedy and Nkrumah project. He denounced it as communist. Not meaning that building dams is communist, but that doing this for these people is communist. And Nkrumah is in the communist orbit. We've got to stop this. There were repeated British murder attempts that were always blamed on the British. In August 62, he cut off security and intelligence ties with the British government. This is a New York Times article that justifies an attack on Nkrumah, murder attempt. And here is an editorial which is about why he should die. He's arrested his opponents, established a tyranny, introduced a totalitarian version of socialism. The children are taught that he's immortal. That's probably the worst thing. They charge British complicity in bomb outrages. Here, his security has been so stripped that he personally wrestles the assassin to the ground after the guy shot at him or threw grenades. Here he is on top of the guy who pulled the trigger. And the British government says, oh, this was not very convincing. Maybe they just staged this. Ghana ends relations with Britain, followed by Nkrumah is reported out after Ghana army coup. He was overthrown in 1966, just after the dam was completed, and that would be less riots. Where was that coup planned? You have to go no further than the New York Times. I'm sorry, UPI. This is in the New York Times. How the coup was planned in London. They give the address. And they say that he's gone and the Indonesian president Sukarno is next. And here's the New York Times editorial to stamp out Nkrumah's legacy. And by what do they mean by Nkrumah? They mean John Kennedy. 1966. It was at this time, 2 months after this, that we founded the LaRouche movement because of this point of view by the oligarchy in the United States and obviously India, British, and so forth. Here, go back briefly John Kennedy. This is from 1940. Vast power source in atomic energy opened by science. Uranium is 5 million times as potent as coal. A pound of it's equal to 3 million pounds of gasoline. A natural substance found abundantly in many parts of the earth. I don't know about, what's going on at detail level in the New York Times. But again, we are talking about things that the President of the United States, both, FDR in his time, and as you'll see in a minute, Kennedy, very importantly, puts into the papers. This is, go back to 1951, the first light bulb lit by atomic energy was from a breeder reactor. This is under Eisenhower, 1955, the Atoms for Peace program. Unfortunately, the Dulles brothers are running contrary, Secretary of State and head of CIA, contrary to the president, and befuddling him in many ways, and you can't have a war against the majority of the world's countries and try to give them nuclear power plants if you're trying to do both at the same time. 1961, April 9th, work on Indonesia. This is John Kennedy, just after he's in office. Work on Indonesia's first atomic project was officially started today by President Sukarno. Project is under the joint sponsorship of the United States and Indonesia. He laid the first stone 100 kilowatt atomic reactor. Reactor has been provided through a U.S. grant used for training, research, and production of isotopes. This is the program of John F. Kennedy for nuclear power. And it's based centrally on the development of the breeder reactor. Only by the use of breeders will we really solve the problem of adequate energy supply for future generations. This is the report that he asked for from his leader of the Atomic Energy Commission, Glenn Seaborg, a great scientist back in the, who I guess you could say invented plutonium back in the Manhattan Project. And Seaborg is a fighter for nuclear energy and a fighter against nuclear war, both with equal passion. So this is the report dated November 20th, 62. Anybody can find this easily. It's not, nothing is covert. Nuclear power promises to supply the vast amounts of energy this nation will require for many generations to come, will provide a significant reduction in the national cost for electrical power. They stressed that we are going to have this take the place of oil and coal, and after 2000, essentially all of our new power plants will be atomic. This is in August of 61, congressional House hearings on the development of the nuclear rocket program for going to Mars, called the Rover Project. And it's interesting to see, there's so many leads to follow up here. Chet Holofield and other people in Congress were pressing on Kennedy the way, you know, Frederick Douglass pressed on Lincoln. Go faster. Do this faster. This is obviously the future. And it's I didn't put all these slides on because you're getting tired already. But in the newspapers at this time, day after day, atomic rockets for Mars. You can't go to Mars without this. And of course we're going to Mars and the outer planets. The time is crucial. That's the thing. You have to go faster to make it practical. This is John F. Kennedy, President of the United States, and Dr. Seaborg at the Nevada test site for the rover, the nuclear rocket to Mars. That's the only thing that was, that's what this site was about. This is, again, a widely available photograph. On August 10th, 1963, it was announced that our Atomic Energy Commission was funding a nuclear reactor for Vietnam. October 29th, less than a month before the assassination, this reactor was dedicated by the president of South Vietnam and Henry Cabot Lodge, our ambassador. Shortly afterwards, both presidents were murdered. Forget the misleading headline in the newspaper. This is the operative paragraph. This is a much later article in the New York Times. Dr. Seaborg says back in 1963, in my first meeting with Lyndon Johnson, a week after President Kennedy was assassinated, he told me to start cutting back. We're not doing nuclear research. We'll do H-bombs, maybe. The Indonesia nuclear reactor was inaugurated the next year. First sustained nuclear chain reaction. Scientists from the United States assisted in the experiment. The 64 election, the Republican candidate Goldwater charged that Kennedy had supplied the means for Reds to get an atomic bomb. Does that sound familiar? So Kennedy wasn't putting sanctions on Indonesia for trying to develop nuclear power like Obama. He was giving them the nuclear power, and not just giving it to the nation and some stooge like the Shah, but giving it to his friend and the friend of his daughter in the White House and whatever, the president of Indonesia, who had stamps in his post office honoring Benjamin Franklin and Thomas Jefferson and George Washington. The reactor in Vietnam, this is 1968, the war is going on in Vietnam now after Kennedy's dead. And is that after Bobby's dead? What's what? Couple of days after Bobby's dead, they declare in Vietnam, I'm sorry, we can't do much with this reactor because the war is raging all around it. Oh, I forgot to mention one thing. After Truman dropped the atomic bomb on Japan, he told Acheson that the use of nuclear power for peaceful purposes was a bad idea because it would likely cut in to the necessary labor time for the ordinary workmen that they would have too much time on their hands and would get into mischief. So I want to just now go back to Kennedy and what he knew when he came into office. Back in 1953, Alan Dulles was made head of the Central Intelligence Agency, the brother of the Secretary of State, John Foster Dulles. These are both the lawyers for both Averell Harriman and Adolf Hitler. They're the go-betweens. They're John Foster Dulles, his brother, was the one sued by my father in New York Municipal Court in 1933-34 for this first case against the Nazis. So that's the Dulles brothers. This is in 1959, and this is an article in the Christian Science Monitor about the establishment of Permandex in Italy. It's a co-organization with the International Trademark, a trademart. I'm too tired to say the name in Italian. Commercio, whatever. And it says that it's based on the International Trademark of New Orleans, and the managing director of that New Orleans trademart, in other words, Clay Shaw, is in fact a member of the board of directors of this new trade center. And it talks about the World Trade Center in Permandex. This is a quango, an established operation by the Central Intelligence Agency in cooperation with all the fascists in Europe, but particularly with the Dulles connection to England. Here is the president of Permandex, Ferenc Nagy, former prime minister of Hungary. And he got a building for Permandex that had been built by Mussolini as a center for worldwide fascism. They're very much into symbols. And here is the building. I guess you can see it best on the left. It's sort of reminiscent of some other fascist architecture in Italy and maybe the Nuremberg stuff in Germany. And you see the word Permandex over there. That's their office. It's supposed to be a company that is running exhibitions and somehow in some vague way associated with expositions in different places. And according to the reports in Europe and here, it was financing the Algerian rebels against Charles de Gaulle, among other fascist projects. The OAS, Organisation Algérienne Secrète, Secret Army of Algeria, threatened the death of Enrico Mattei. And it was said at the time that they had sentenced him to death. Here is the New York Times, September 61. The OAS assassins bomb De Gaulle, the device misfires. A new assassination attempt on De Gaulle, November. Attempted sabotage of Mattei's airplane is attributed to the OAS assassins. This is about the expression that was clearly, again, these kinds of things are coming from the White House, certainly with the knowledge and approval of the White House. Teams of killers. The part of the article you see is how they've left Algeria. Remember, de Gaulle was pro-imperialist. He was a French imperialist. He was in London in World War II. He's fighting fascism. His heart and soul is in that. But he is for the French Empire. He's for France and all that meant. And he changed. Part of the geometry of that change is John Kennedy and Kennedy invoking Franklin Roosevelt. So he told, when he came in as president, the end of the 50s, he told Algeria, your rebellion is going to be acknowledged by France and you're going to get independence. And this was used by the enemy oligarchy in Europe and England to assemble hit squads and rage. The secret army and their organization ruled over 1 million white settlers in Algeria and got their funds by taxing them, among other sources, like Permandex.
A lot of the military that was operating in Algeria were from the French Imperial Army in Vietnam, the paratroopers and others in Vietnam who had lost at Dien Bien Phu and elsewhere.
Right.
And then they went to Algeria to carry out the same tactics with equal success.
The same tactics, and you have to see de Gaulle's mind working, seeing what happened in Vietnam, where the French lost. Kennedy was criticizing the insanity of them trying to reclaim France, Vietnam after the World War II, and the dissolution of the French Empire around Africa, like in Guinea, where there's a rebellion there, and it's stupid for them. What the French officers and others in this empire did is they just tried to destroy these countries instead of allow them to have a good relationship with France and Europe. Why not? The French would make money. This isn't about money. Clearly, it's not about money in a place like Algeria. What are you going to do? Mattei could make money out of Algeria by developing Algeria and their oil. That's what he tried to do. It's another reason they're targeting him. So now de Gaulle is the target of this rage. Italy seized Jacques Soustelle, who is the most famous leader of the assassin teams and of the secret army of Algeria. And they're going to deport him from Italy. More attempts to kill de Gaulle. Motorcyclists machine gun de Gaulle's car while he's in it. Bullets missed him by inches. President Kennedy sent a message today expressing gratitude the French president escaped unhurt. Bidault, Georges Bidault, who was formerly prime minister of France. Now he's a co-leader of this assassin bureau. He's an exile traveling around, and he's in Italy when he is expelled from Italy, September 9th, 1962. The next month, Mattei was killed. His plane was sabotaged. The newspapers said it was an accident. And when you have a statement like that, an explanation like that, it is not intended that anybody believe it. It's just like the Warren Commission. Warren Commission was not really a cover-up. It was bullying. And people stood for it. Because what you're looking at here is in the newspapers all over the world. Why he had to die, an editorial in the New York Times. His bitter antipathy to the major international oil company. This, he died by accident, but this is why he had to die. He was detrimental to the political and economic interests of the free world. Oh, he was no communist, but... Then Bidault, after being, you know, expelled from Italy, goes to England, and he is wanted by the French police for attempting the murder of President de Gaulle and the overthrow of the French government. And he's interviewed by BBC, and the Home Minister of England speaks to the Parliament and says, "We don't know that he's here." And the Parliament erupts in laughter, repeated roars of laughter as he explains, "Oh, he's not really here. Yes, he was interviewed on BBC, but that's no evidence that he was actually here, even though he was standing there in whatever part of London." What's that?
Photographed in Piccadilly Circus.
Oh, photographed in Piccadilly Circus, right? I remember the letter sent by Franklin Roosevelt to Adolf Hitler. I think it was 1938 or something, saying, "Please don't invade," and he made a list of countries. And Hitler read this letter by Franklin Roosevelt, the cripple, to the German Reichstag. He says, "Don't invade this country," and they roar with laughter. He says, "Don't invade Palestine." Ah, ah, ah. He says, "Don't invade Belgium." Ah, ah. So this is the tradition that you're talking about here with the British. The OAS assassins were based in Spain. The best information we have is that they came from Spain to kill John Kennedy. Here is...
It was in Spain. Yeah, Spain was where Skorzeny was.
Yep. Next slide. Good, that's good. Hire that man. He says, "I'm not here recruiting ex-Nazis for hit squads." He was Hitler's, I guess you call him Hitler's bodyguard. He rescued Mussolini. He ran famous, brave exploits by the SS and by various...
He was the top commando.
Top commando in the Nazi army.
He ran the plot to kill General Eisenhower.
And he's in now in the Dulles British orbit. And he's in Spain as part of this group around OAS and Permandex. Now let's get to the, what did Kennedy know, and when did he know it? This is April of 61. He was inaugurated in January of 61. That's 3 months earlier. He is appointed a commission, and right after setting up this commission, appoints his attorney general, his brother Bobby, onto this commission to study what's wrong with the CIA.
Well, right in between is the Bay of Pigs.
This is after the Bay of Pigs. Yeah, that's right. But as you'll see, the issue is not the Bay of Pigs. The Bay of Pigs is part of it because there's Cubans and in this whole mess of the hit teams they've got. Dulles denies a CIA role in the Algiers Rebellion. But Kennedy was beginning there a purge of the Dulles group and their combination with these assassin teams. And it says here in the New York Times, and you can always believe the New York Times, that he was reacting to an embarrassing liaison of the CIA with the anti-Gaullist officers who staged last week's insurrection in Algiers. Can you read this? Can you read that? This is the one on the right.
President Kennedy is said to have...
right here, just on the top on the right.
Kennedy had learned of encouragement to the mutineers by the Central Intelligence Agency, which is said to have become a reactionary state within a state in the United States. He fired Dulles in September.
That's the reason Dulles was fired, because he was running, along with the British, hit teams that were assassinating leaders that tried to kill de Gaulle, that murdered Mitte, and were part of all the murder going on around the world against Africans and elsewhere. So this is a war. In August 60, when he's running for president, he made a speech at the graveside of Franklin Roosevelt. I'm just going to give you an excerpt from this. It's on the 25th anniversary of the signing of the Social Security Act back in 35. In this speech, he is proposing an action program as a senator and prospective president to get Medicare going and to expand Social Security to really protect people. I am grateful to you, Mrs. Roosevelt, for allowing me to be here today, for I come to Hyde Park not to instruct but to learn. A visit to Hyde Park is both a pilgrimage and a challenge. We journey here to pay tribute at FDR's grave to one of America's most honored leaders. We who lived while he governed can, here at Hyde Park, still hear the echoes of those heroic struggles to rescue America from poverty and economic collapse. And the last, the most arduous, the unending struggle, the struggle which his wife still steadfastly carries on, the struggle to build a world free of free and peaceful nations. This is how he concluded this address. The writers of the Declaration of Independence did not promise us happiness. They promised only the pursuit of happiness, and by this they meant fulfillment as a nation and as human beings. It is this pursuit which we must now resume. There are new problems, new dangers, new horizons, and we have rested long enough. The world is changing, the perils are deepening. We must now take the leadership in that great march. And this is why we have gathered here at the home of enduring greatness, not merely to pay tribute, but to refreshen our spirits and stir our hearts for the tasks which lie ahead. We celebrate the past to awaken the future. This was said for all time almost 100 years ago by a great American standing at another graveside at another memorial service. It is, he said, for us the living to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion, that this nation under God may have a new birth of freedom. Today, in that spirit, we pay our humble tribute. That's it.
terrific.
Tony, going back to what you said about building the dam in Ghana, and I think there was a similar type thing. Other people might know much more than me, but there was a similar type thing in Egypt where
right.
the British offered to build a dam on the Nile River. But in the end, Nasser kicked them out, and they ended up building, I guess, the tallest dam in the world or something.
Yeah, the high Aswan.
They built the Aswan Dam, and they were asking for the United States to help them and Britain. And, of course, the United States policy was conflicted. The Russians offered to help them, and he went with the Russians' help. And they built this great dam and had a big lake and an electric power plant there. When Kennedy came in office, he and Jackie tried to begin mending fences with Nasser. They're working with people like Nehru. They're trying every which way in the neutralist movement to get around this problem of the Anglo-Americans like Gore saying, let's not help these people that go to the Russians. Mm-hmm. Why? You want them to go to the Russians, right? Is that the idea?
Yeah.
That's obviously what's going on.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Jackie Kennedy brought up the fact that the dam was going to flood these ancient ruins of Abu Simbel and offered American help, not to stop the dam, but to say, okay, this is a great project. We want to help you rescue your past. And they moved all of these statues and buildings. In the dam in Ghana, Jackie Kennedy was supposed to go there to dedicate it when it was dedicated a week before Nkrumah was overthrown. She couldn't come, but she had asked for a plaque to be put on the dam, which is there to the present day, honoring President Eisenhower, who tried to help and was interfered with, and President Kennedy for building the dam.
Tony, you mentioned the non-aligned movement. Can you say anything about how... I thought of Nehru when you mentioned him. Can you speak to anything about how they were functioning? We've got this polarized world with the Iron Curtain business.
The non-aligned movement is, as far as I can see, with some exceptions, which are mainly Russian intrusions into it, are all of this order. They're all people that are trying to follow the lead of some initiative that's going to make their country, to rescue their countries from, you know, here we have, what's the situation? The war, World War II is over, and the British Empire, the French Empire, these are weak. The Americans are strong. Franklin Roosevelt has issued the challenge. The Atlantic Charter is what woke up all these people all over the world, everywhere. 1941. What's World War II about? That's what it's about. Our freedom over in Africa, over in Asia. Obviously in India. Franklin Roosevelt sent a mission to India in 43 and to see what the people of India, the government of India under the British, was doing to produce the materials for our side in World War II. They found to their horror that the British had jailed, again, both Gandhi and Nehru, and had thwarted any serious attempts by India to produce anything. They're not going to let them go beyond the first big steel complex that Americans had helped them build back in the beginning of the 20th century, the Tata Steelworks. And they blasted the British for this. They said, this is insane. You're saying that even the British troops aren't going to get supplied by big new industry in India. They could. They got plenty of people, and they have lots of skills there. It's a devastated, poor country, but they could do this right away. The model that was at that time on the minds of people looking at what the Third World could do is Brazil. Rich Freeman is working on a big report on this, on the Coup mission and the whole policy, the Good Neighbor. But in the book by Morris Cook, he describes the question, can Brazilians who are not only poor and undernourished, suffering from terrible diseases of all kinds, social diseases, parasite disease, all kinds of things, no education, and most importantly, no tradition allowed to them under the imperial system, Portugal and then after that, no tradition of invention and discovery guiding the work. Can such people suddenly be transformed into a modern labor force? And without the prior organization of a vast sea of middle-class managers and so forth? And the answer was unequivocally yes. And he gave example after example of people, and these are it's a half or a majority black people from descended from Africans in Brazil, and there's also immigrants from Europe of various kinds. The ordinary worker making 3 cents a day, no education. And when you introduce a new process and a spirit of, you know, initiative that's backed by the government, Vargas went to the workers and to the industrial, you know, the commercial classes and said, this is what we're doing. Roosevelt's backing us and is paying for half of this. Organize yourselves. Organize syndicates. These are not Mussolini syndicates. This is like Bismarck, really. And when you do this, as Cook points out in his book, overnight, people pick this up if they're not murdered, if they're not just completely squashed. And you get the transformation of a large number of people, place after place, into skilled workers. He's a guy who never did any skilled work and never had any acquaintance with modern technology, is hired to work in, in one type of work, maybe electrical work or steel making, and rapidly gets all the skills around him. Another guy who was given a job in electrical work, within a short time after that, he had some working experience in some kind of shop, okay, which is better than or peasants. But then within a few months, he has learned 20,000 words of English, including 14,000 terms of electrical devices. Oh, and allied. What is it?
It was the oil industry, but the point you're making is absolutely correct.
Well, but he you look it up. There's one thing where he's talking about an electrical supply shop. But you're right, he's talking about the oil industry as well. So my point is that these questions, along with the question of if somebody invests in these countries, will they get their money back? And the routine answer from everybody associated with FDR, just like with Lincoln, just like with Hamilton, is it depends. You're not going to get your money back if you're just sucking their blood or you're speculating. But if you are deliberately building up their industry and their power to produce, then there's a future in it and you're going to get your money back, especially if the government backs you up in different ways. But it's not, you know, like the Hurley Memorandum points out about Iran. This doesn't cost the taxpayers anything. Iran's got plenty of resources. Why can't they just use their resources to build up their country with our help, with our encouragement? And the answer is, which is stated everywhere by both FDR and his representatives and Kennedy and his people, or at least the ones who were really his people, not the ones who were out to kill him, who were next to him, if you build something over there, it's going to work out. And we are not going to worry that they are getting powerful. That's to our advantage. They'll buy more from us and so forth. If they're industrialized, if they have capabilities of a high wage and modern society, we have better, more profitable business in our trade with Europe let's industrialize than we do with these poor countries. Why not industrialize them? And everybody involved knows that the issue is not has nothing to do with real finances. It has to do with simple power to squash people. That's all it's about. Mm-hmm. So this is in now, in the period after World War II. You get through this period up to various nationalist movements. Kennedy is there, and this nationalist movement goes up. It's a neutralism, headed by people like Nehru. And all of them want good relations with the United States, and none of them are really run by the communists. And as we know from certain things, the communists aren't even run by the communists. So that's another problem, right, that we have to deal with, right? In the Mossadegh rebellion, or, you know, his movement to take over Iran, part of what he did when he became prime minister was to publish things that were not in the New York Times. He published it in Iran that said, we have found these documents in the home of the British oil company that's been dominating our country for decades. These are documents showing that the British have paid communists to have riots as communists. They're foolish people, those people who would do that. So the attitude of Kennedy, and there was a slide I didn't bother putting in because there's too many already. Neutralist movement, or what do you call it? The non-aligned movement. Yeah. Kennedy is asked by the press, what about this? Commie red, irritation. We think it's okay. They're well-intentioned. We wish them the best. And then behind the scenes, you have our friends like especially Sukarno and Nkrumah. And I'll tell you just the last thing. John Glenn, the first American orbiter astronaut, his flight, which is after the Russians did it,
right,
thrilled mankind, just like Armstrong later. But there was a special edge to it. This is the middle of Kennedy's term. And if you read the coverage at the time, you'll see that aside from Greece and some other country, I forget, Mexico was really strongly part of this. They had a station to observe the flight, so they felt like they were part of it. But the three countries that sent the most strong, thrilled response to President Kennedy were Ghana, Indonesia, and Charles de Gaulle. That's it. That's what's in the that's what's in the news. So the non-aligned movement, there is no honest history of these things. It's ridiculous. It's so far from the headlines of the time. It's like people talking about Lincoln. We have this problem all the time. You go back to Lincoln and you say, well, what did he do before he was president? Well, he was a lawyer or whatever. Oh, God, wasn't he a politician for 30 years? Didn't he have some point of view? Oh, well. Weren't there headlines at the time? Weren't there fights at the time? Oh, well. Doesn't matter. That's it. But now it's right in front of us. So that's this problem. Yeah.
When I was watching the picture of Cardenas, it really struck me that it was very similar to the picture of Lynn with Jose Lopez Portillo.
Exactly.
And then when you think back to Lynn, when is Lynn forged? It's 46. It's the British massacre in Calcutta.
Yeah.
And if you think about the early days of our organization, early 70s, mm-hmm. with Fred Wills and the 175 nations that supported the IDB, mm-hmm. if you think about mm-hmm. his development projects with Indira Gandhi, who was assassinated, I mean, the issue in every one of these assassinations was always this question of, industrial development, nuclear power in particular, right. And industrial development. Every single project that Lynn, every leader in the world that he was meeting with, every assassination that took place, up into, the time of Ponto and Schleyer with the whole development project again for Africa, so it's the continuous history, but I mean, it's really quite striking, that picture, because it was just like the picture of Lynn standing there with Lopez Portillo when they dropped the debt bomb.
That's it.
And the world went crazy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And Ali Bhutto with Kissinger saying, we will make a terrible example.
Exactly.
Of you.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Another project of Glenn Seaborg, and I think of Matei, but definitely Glenn Seaborg, was thermonuclear fusion as a project for the Kennedy administration.
And they actually mentioned thorium
thorium.
Particular, which was obviously a India. I mean, that's what was obviously being referred to. That's the largest thorium reserves in the world.
Yeah.
So it was quite clear.
Richard.
Yeah, if I could just say one thing.
Yes, sure.
On this, what's very exciting about all of this is that, and this is where Roosevelt's very much like Lynn, you have an extraordinary group of people, some of whom Tony put up. You have other people like Harry Hopkins. You could list the whole group. It's under Roosevelt that what they had always believed in their life became natural. Mm-hmm. And they had been fighting against the currents for their whole lives. They suddenly, under Roosevelt, they're able to bat around these ideas and they're able to act on them. And there are probably 50 people who you've never heard of who are remarkable in this regard. Mm-hmm. I just want to mention one thing about Cook, who was an engineer, but Roosevelt takes him on as governor in 1931, and what he and Roosevelt would do is sit at night after all the work was done and discuss how they were going to bring electricity from the St. Lawrence Seaway. And Roosevelt would sit there to calculate how much electricity could be bought for and so forth. I mean, he's thinking these things through. And then when Roosevelt becomes president, the first thing he appoints Cook to do is to become the head of the Mississippi Valley Commission, which is a commission that oversees 900,000 miles. It's the Missouri River, the Ohio River, the Mississippi, and all the work that was done in these areas, like development of Lower Mississippi and so forth, was planned out by this commission starting in 1933. Then Cook privately lobbies Roosevelt to set up the Rural Electrification Administration. He was the guy who did it with Norris. And so Roosevelt says, okay, I'm setting up in 36, you're the first director. And they electrify 900,000 miles of electricity, bringing light to farmers and so forth. So when he goes to this commission in Brazil in 1942-43, he looks at Brazil from those eyes. And for example, he looks at the San Francisco Valley, which is a part in Brazil, and he says, we're going to build a TVA here. He was also one of the best friends of David Lilienthal of the TVA. But he was also, like all of these people, fiercely, fiercely anti-imperialist. And if I could just read one quote from him.
Sure.
I think it conveys it and takes on the things that Tony's been mentioning. But he says that, and he's a complete fight against backwardness, and he's also very much, he says, on Brazil repeatedly, we do not just want Brazil to be able to produce raw materials.
Right.
That is wrong.
Right.
We want Brazil to have manufacturing. That's what we have to do. And this is what he says. He says, the whole history of industrial civilization, he means the American system methods, demonstrates that international trade develops best between nations that are prosperous, not between rich nations and poor nations, nor between nations trying to gain prosperity by retarding their neighbors. And then taking direct aim at the British, he says, that we have to reject the 19th century model based on the right of one nation to dominate the lives of other people because of an alleged superiority of race.
Exactly.
And then he adds, later day technological developments, especially in the large scale production and long distance transmission of electrical power, have sealed the doom of 19th century trading, in which stronger and more highly developed countries fabricate raw materials great distances to their home country for fabrication, and then send the finished goods to the four corners of the earth. So this is the outlook. I mean, this was a very conscious outlook. And I just want to say one other thing about Sumner Wells, because you could go on and on. He wrote Roosevelt's 1928 foreign policy speech, in which Roosevelt attacks dollar diplomacy. This was appeared in Foreign Affairs June of 1928. It was called the Democratic Belief of View of Foreign Policy. He wrote it. He also wrote the good neighbor speech part of the address, and so on. And he was the guy who also helped develop the UN. Well, he writes Roosevelt's message to Montevideo in late 33. And it stuns everyone. And it's a very simple proposal, which no one could believe. It said, no nation has the right to invade another nation or set a policy.
Mm-hmm.
And they just couldn't get over the fact this was coming from the United States. And there's this guy named Puig Calcinac, who was a Mexican, who's a
foreign
minister. And he said, I want to state that we have a very courageous and great man in the White House. And it was just a total transformation.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the last thing on what you've been saying about forcing people out, Sumner Wells is forced out in 43. J. Edgar Hoover, working with the British, pulled a dossier, because he had certain things in his background, handed it to Cordell Hull, who at this point was not going in the right direction, clearly, who then marketed it around to the press and basically said, you either fire Sumner Wells in 43, and he's fired in September, or this will become public. So Wells is removed, then Lawrence Duggan, who you remarked, is then fired and, of course, killed in 43.
Yeah, he was forced out with the allegation in circulated internally that he was a homosexual.
Right.
And this is, it's so clearly coming through the same channels that are murdering everybody. The purge against Roosevelt is starting right then, and I think especially after Stalingrad, when they knew that we were going to win the war.
Right.
Right. So.
Just one last thing. On the heat sets up, the last thing I just want to say, which is really exciting, is that in 1939, the United States proposes, under Harry Dexter White, a bank of the Americas to finance development. And he says, he tells Morgenthau, we'll put $2 billion, which is like $40 to $50 billion at that time, for the development of the Americas, because that's the right thing to do. When that doesn't succeed, because it's blocked in the Senate, he uses the proposal of the Good Neighbor Policy in 41 to then write the original proposals for the Bretton Woods system. So there's a direct continuity between Bretton Woods and the Good Neighbor Policy.
Mm-hmm. So, go ahead.
When you, you said that Hurley was aware that, he said that the imperialism is being defended by the blood of democratic nations. This was the World War II fight.
Yes.
Could you say a little bit more about how that was clear that that's what World War II was
That's not what the war is about. In other words, we are defending England as we should have, because
right.
England was being destroyed. That's what he's talking about.
Okay,
but
yeah.
England was governed by imperialists who were using England like in World War I. Winston Churchill sent Englishmen and Canadians and other people to die foolishly at Gallipoli and elsewhere. That's the enemy isn't England or Britain. The enemy is this policy and this outlook and this set of financiers. And it's in... Well, it's all over the world, and it's ancient. And that's something that everybody in power knew, and different from today, it was out there for people to discuss. It was for years and years. That was our culture.
Mm-hmm.
That's the point here. I would stress you could say that Franklin Roosevelt didn't do that much. And you could cite, and same thing with Kennedy. Forget the fact that he was killed. And you could cite the fact, and many books are written, that like the Good Neighbor Policy was only a partial policy, or that this type of thing was a compromise, or so forth. I think that that's very skewed, because just like in the Civil War and other cases, what it fails to consider is the fact that every second, every minute, there is a war going on to the death between two sides about whether the United States will be the United States or not, literally. And the attitude of those in Wall Street to this present day, along with their teachers in England and Europe, is that
They are the authorities. Their friends are the authorities. There is no such a thing as law. There is no such a thing as nations or governments or elected this or that. When Roosevelt was president, when Kennedy was president, and to a certain extent, you know, with Eisenhower and other people, but particularly it's most clear in the cases before us in, you know, what we're citing here. The United States is this outlook. There is no other outlook for the United States. In other words, if somebody says neutralism is communism, that's simply the British Empire speaking. If somebody says, I'm worried about communism, that's a worry. It's an uninformed worry, but it's a worry. And it's real, because there's all kinds of isms running around threatening us and threatening even the countries where they are. What do you do about them? Well, we have a way of dealing with these things. It's called bringing security and civilization to this planet. That's the American policy. And there isn't any other American policy. That to me is the key concept. Mm-hmm. Rather than say this failed or that failed or this was a compromise, is to get a sense of the limited, very limited occurrence of leadership from the beginning of civilization, where we can find it, where it's the spark of genius in leadership, and it's applied where it can, and it brings about these miracles. And it's not just leadership in statecraft, it's also in other fields. But then when we have these moments under a constitution, that is the United States. And it was ended, I would say, in the enemy's eyes for all time, in 1968, when they murdered Bobby Kennedy, who was the one who told Jack, fire Dulles, he's it, he's doing this. And Jack knew these things, but he got Bobby on it. So they murdered him, they murdered Dr. King, and they started up various projects all around the world for the Cultural Revolution, including in China, to end civilization. So if you say, I'm going to find out what the Kennedy assassination was about, you're not. You're not interested in that, because the question is, here's the United States and the people who are trying to end the United States. It's as clear as you want it to be, just like in the Civil War. It's the same issue. Only it's worse now because we have atomic bombs, and on the other side, we have, as Morris Cook says, we've changed everything with electricity. We can transform the world. So that's what it is.
Tony, the photo you have on the screen is Hyde Park at the Arts Home. If you walk in the door, the very first thing you see, there's a little vestibule. It's got like 15, 20 anti-British editorial cartoons.
That's right.
I think 1937, to visit FDR, the British king did not go to Washington, they went to Hyde Park. Mm-hmm. And FDR's mother said, the first thing you got to do is take down all these, when he walks in the door, you take your first step, and that's all you see. There's nothing else there. It's a little vestibule. So FDR says, no, we're going to keep all these right here. And sure enough, when the king walks in the door, he is shocked. And he stood and looked and read each one of them one by one. And FDR wanted to let him read all of them. And then FDR goes up to him right at when he's done with the last one. He says, so what do you think? And he says, well, I also have a collection of cartoons, but I see you have a few that I don't have.
You tell it better than
the real
I do.
Reason
that's
stuttered.
Good. That's right. These are naval cartoons. You hear you read.
Actually, from his grandfather Isaac Roosevelt, what they said. That's where they.
Well, they must be. Some of them are, but some of them are from the only other war that was directly and officially our war against England, which is the War of 1812. So it was just the Revolution, War of 1812. And here, this guy was Assistant Secretary of the Navy in World War I. Where's the modern battleships? So that's all that's on his wall, is these cruisers fighting the British, and then some cartoons of,
you know, the British as the as a farcical, bad, stupid enemy. That's good.
I want to go back to what you said about Lynn right after the war, going to the leadership of the Indian.
Yeah, can you speak up a little bit?
There's a book out in 2010 called Churchill's Secret War, and I haven't had a chance to read it yet, but I've read the summary, and it seems that during the war, Churchill always had this fixation to keep India, of course, because they were very worried what would happen. So just like before the American Revolution, there was a massive famine in Bengal.
Oh, yes.
Same thing that happened with the East India Company during the war. And they were saying, you know, send us the wheat, send us the ships. And they were available. And Churchill said, I have to save them for Britain after the war is over because we need food. And so 3 million Indians died in Bengal. And that's the context that Lynn walked into.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was the thing about the whole thing about Roosevelt and the Brits. I'm trying to remember the exact thing, but I think it was at the time of when he was pushing through Lend-Lease to support the British against them, against the Germans, against the onslaught. And he was accused at one point of being an Anglophile, because he was, you know, he was from a patrician family and all that, so he was an Anglophile. And he said, on the contrary, I have quite the opposite feelings, and I've had to overcome them.
Yeah, I'd like to get the original for this, but he said that when he went, his father took him to England as a boy, and he saw Queen Victoria, and I hated that woman. That was his comment about it. Huh. One other thing to point out, the TVA, it obviously is resuming Lincoln's policy of developing the South, Henry Carey's policy, in fact, the same place as Carey's talking about, to transform the place from poverty into modern times. What did his father have to do with that? James Roosevelt, in 1872, which would be 8 years before he's born, I guess, right? 1880?
81.
So 9 years before he's born. 1872. His father was hired by the Pennsylvania Railroad for a special project to work with, negotiate, we would call network and so forth, in the South with leading people there in and out of Philadelphia, like the heirs of Biddle, to develop railroads and an extension either of the Pennsylvania Railroad or other railroads, maybe new railroads, as a bargain with the South.
Mm-hmm.
We will transform the South by building modern transportation here, if you will let us go ahead with, you know, the general policy of social improvement, and don't mess the country up again. That was interrupted the next year by the destruction of Jay Cook's bank by the Morgans and the British directly. So he only had that job for a year or less. And of course, that was 1873 panic. Then in 1876, there was, even then in 1876, there was a negotiation on that same idea. I don't know if James Roosevelt had something to do with that. But to try to get the Republican Hayes to be president on a bargain to help the South, not to turn it over to the Ku Klux Klan, but to help them get rich with railroads and industry. And that was turned down by the enemy, including Wall Street and these scoundrels. And then Hayes made the bargain instead of that, to fight inside the Republican Party, to withdraw the troops from the South and let the Klan types run the South and destroy things. So you had this leftover problem that his father was in the middle of, and his father's networks go, obviously, I don't know that there's a, I don't think you know that you can claim a continual awareness of everything going back to Isaac Roosevelt. Clearly, Franklin Roosevelt chose Isaac Roosevelt as his favorite ancestor. Right? He certainly didn't want to choose his mother's father, who's in the opium business. Right? How many of us have thieves or drunkards or whatever as ancestors, but also great people? So we choose who, we have millions of ancestors, right? So, but the awareness of these things as a historical memory, this is what Graham is always talking about, right? On our side and the enemy's side. This is a historical memory in his family. And he's practicing this as governor of New York. And he, this is America's memory. Went to sleep, and then he revived it.
During the Boer War, when the British fought the Dutch, he collected money for the Boers at Harvard University.
I didn't know that.
So my ambition for this is to get a, is to produce a beautiful documentary video. These slides and all of this work was done here by Asuka and Pavel for many hours of creative work and incredible amounts of work. At one point, Adam Sturman told me that I said, well, can I just do some slides? And he laughed at me. typical Adam, right? You don't know anything about this. You can't do this. And he was right.
Great.
So there's, what are there? There was about 200 of these in this?
Yeah.
Yeah, about 200. I'll tell you a methodology that's involved here, and that is you have a search function in through the public library to a database of New York Times, Washington Post, Wall Street Journal, and Christian Science Monitor. All of them directly representative of the enemy. And in previous decades, you'd have to go to the Library of Congress and go through a microfilm. There was a New York Times index, but it was terribly laborious, and it was just, it was, you know, it was so exciting to discover anything. And of course, you can't start by looking through the newspapers for anything. You have to know what you're looking for. But then, just like when you go into a library, remember going in the stacks of the Library of Congress or someplace like that? You go there, you look for a book, and then you look, you
around.
Peek next to it.
Yes.
Oh, this subject is close around, to that.
Yeah.
What's going on here?
Yeah.
And that's like this. You look in the neighborhood of this date, and even with this searching for this thing, and you find, my God, why hasn't this been reported? You know, what about this, the Hurley memorandum? There, it's as I said, an effort to get Hurley to write this, or FDR saying he's going to get Hurley to write the memorandum in Iran. That's reported by Elliot Roosevelt. Other writers with a lot of money and prestige or whatever, at least universities and funding and so forth, they would say repeatedly that Acheson circulated this scurrilous attack. He called it hysterical messianic globaloney. That phrase was coined by Acheson's assistant. He was an assistant in the State Department, and his assistant was Eugene Rostow. Later, a Vietnam War hawk and a neocon.
Mm-hmm.
So he's the one who made that phrase up. So that attack is reported. These Senate hearings where he's bringing these out isn't reported at all, where that's now in the headlines. But this is reported in biographies and things like this. So I went to the archives in Maryland. What's the name of the place there?
Suitland.
And I went to the purported folder where this Acheson letter, I wanted to see, well, who's he writing this letter to? Maybe it was supposed to be to Stettinius, who's later Secretary of State after Hull. It's not in the file. And I'm fuming. Because the author who wrote about this with a footnote about that would not return my phone calls or my emails. He's a big professor. I can't find this damn thing. It may have just got lost, or maybe misfiled, or maybe somebody stole it, or maybe, you know, the family did away with it. But in that same physical folder is this Hurley memorandum that he's responding to. Mm-hmm. And the woman who's the librarian there, the archivist, is thrilled about all this. Because she knows this subject, she loves this subject, she loves FDR, she loves, you know, we're fighting Hitler, we're discovering things about the universe, we're, you know, this is like God to her. And so, you know, I picked this out, and it's never been published. Why not? That's ridiculous. That is our policy. And that today, Jeff Steinberg circulated that memorandum already to people in Iran. And this is exciting to them. That's our policy. That's America's policy.
Before Mossadegh.
Yeah. Before Mossadegh?
No, but I mean that.
Oh,
that's what many Iranians think of America as, the ones who have real history before the Shah.
That's right.
Before the overthrow of the Shah, people who have knowledge of ancient history know back to Mossadegh.
Yeah.
Before Mossadegh.
Yeah.
Goes back further, because during the American Revolution and that whole period, the people that we were working with throughout Europe included Morocco, included, you know, countries all over the region.
That's right.
That, and you know, the main point that you made at the end is this question that all of these technologies are, of course, what man will do if man is freed. To fight for the dignity of man, which is embedded in our Declaration of Independence.
Right.
And that is, as you said, that is the war between our outlook on man and this British imperialist filth.
Yeah. Claudio Celani wrote some really fantastic articles about Mate.
Yeah. Mm.
And recently, 2009, he wrote about British memos coming out just before Mate was killed in 1962.
Right.
Where the Prime Minister, was it Macmillan or the other guy? I don't know. But he says, we're finished. Europe is dominated by our enemies. We're losing everything. We're losing the Americans are selling weapons to people that we're supposed to be selling weapons. We have nothing. We're being destroyed. All we have left is our determination. And Dean Andromedus has written extensively about the earlier Iran presence of the Americans. But you're right, exactly right, to go back to the revolution. This is our identity in the world. But then in 1911 and 12, Iran was jointly governed by Russia and England. And it was right after that that Winston Churchill, as First Lord of the Admiralty, took the measure to say that the British Empire and the British government is buying up half or something of the Anglo-Iranian oil company, later known as BP. So this is a British imperial enterprise government top down. The Iranians had a revolt against this setup around the beginning of the century. The British and Russians signed an accord in 1907, backed by Teddy Roosevelt, to kick off the planning towards World War I, to carve up Iran, to govern the nations from India over to Europe.
and to bully Iran. The Iranians revolted against this in a constitutional revolt. They set up the Majlis, the parliament, and they invited the Americans, the famous Americans of Abraham Lincoln, to send somebody there who would be the treasurer of Iran. And this is Schuster. I forget his first name now. It's late. But he went there. He had been in the Philippines. And he went to Iran as the treasurer of Iran.
Huh.
And he set up a military squad, a big military squad for the Treasury Department to stand up to the British and the agents of the aristocrats and the Russians. They fought it out. He stood his ground. And the British were foaming at the mouth, and they and the Russians got together. The Russians are pitiful and pathetic. They've already had the Japanese sicked on them. So there's a dying czar operation. And Vita is furious that this is stupid. The Russians should be doing this. And the British condemned the American interference, and they got the Russians to invade Iran. The American was kicked out, and the parliament was ended, and Iran was smashed. When Franklin Roosevelt was president, this was the recent memory in Iran of the heroic Americans coming to our rescue. We couldn't do anything then under Roosevelt because that's the middle of World War II. We're supplying Russia. Russians are coming back and forth. The whole war between Africa and Europe and Asia, that's a central place. So we couldn't build something there right then. But that was supposed to be the centerpiece of the development of the world because it's so hard to do and because clearly they have a culture that is ready to go. You talk about Brazil, I mean, my God, Iran developed India in ancient times. That's the seat of culture. So that's their memory. So thank you very much. Appreciate it.